7, starting in verse 1. One day Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray just as John taught his disciples." He said to them, "When you pray, say, 'Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who sins against us. And lead us not into temptation.' Then Jesus said to them, 'Suppose you have a friend, and you go to him at midnight, and say, 'Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. A friend of mine on a journey has come to me. I have no food to offer him.' Suppose the one inside answers, 'Don't bother me. The door is already locked, and my children and I are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything.' I tell you, even though he will not get up and give you the bread because of friendship, yet because of your shameless audacity, he will surely get up and give you as much as you need. So I say to you, ask and it will be given you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And the one who knocks, the door will be opened." So just take that one and put it in the back of your mind as we go through 1 John 5. We're going to start in verse 13. 1 John 5, verse 13. "I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we ask of him." Let's stop right there for a minute. Confidence in approaching God, in believing in Christ and then believing that we will have things that we ask from God. "I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God." He has been comparing all through the letter between those who believe that thing, that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, that Jesus came in the flesh, however you want to state it, and those who don't. And so now he says, "I'm writing these things to you who believe so that you may know that you have eternal life." And I may have told you this little story before, but we were in Black Oak, Arkansas. The fella hadn't been worshiping with us much. He was a member of the church. And so I stopped by his house one day and just to check on him. And I don't really know how the conversation got to it, but I brought up this passage to him, that John says that we can know that we have eternal life. "These things I'm writing to you so that you may know that you have eternal life." And he said, "Yeah." Well, he said, "You may know, you may not know." That was his answer. I thought, well, how horrible a feeling to go through life never really believing that God's going to keep the promises that he made to you. You may know that you've got eternal life, but then again, you may not. And that was the way he interpreted that passage. John is much more positive than that. "I'm writing these things to you who believe in the name of Jesus Christ so that you'll know, so that you can have confidence." And then he builds on that by talking about the confidence that we have in going to God in prayer. Verse 13, I write these things to you so that, or because. You remember chapter 2? "I'm writing to these things to you, young men, so that. Writing to these things to you, older men, because." He gave several reasons in a row in chapter 2 of why he was writing the letter. He ends up, this is his last, "This is my reason. I'm writing these things, I've written this letter to you, so that you can know that you have eternal life." And the confidence that you have because of that gives you confidence in approaching God. We know that he hears us, whatever we ask, and we know that we have what we've asked of him. If we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. There's three categories of possibilities, I think, for these couple of verses. And you might come up with something else. Number one, God decides on something And he's already got it in mind that that's his will, right? When Jesus was in the garden, not my will, but your will be done. The will was already there. And Jesus buys into what the Father already has planned. When we looked at the Lord's Prayer, thy will be done. Right? Whatever you want, we want to be part of that. So it may be that John is saying, anything that we ask that's already in God's design, he's already decided that before we ever asked, then we know that we'll receive that. That doesn't seem to me to be a matter of confidence that we're receiving something from God, but more a matter of confidence in God's ability to do the right thing. Second possibility, we decide on something, and God is willing to provide it because of who we are, how we ask, and what we believe. So when we pray for somebody to get well, right? Sister so-and-so has been sick for a long time, and we've been praying for her, and she gets better, and that gives us confidence in our prayer life, right? We say, well, we've received an answer to our prayers. Sister Sally is feeling better, and we're glad that she is, as an answer to our prayers. So it wasn't necessarily God's idea to begin with, but because of who we are and how we asked and what we believe, then he did that for us. That seems to be more in line with what John is describing, right? Since we believe that Jesus is the Son of God, we believe in the name of the Son of God, then God is willing to do what we ask him to do. So think about the little parable at the end of the prayer Jesus gives them. It's like a friend, and you go to get bread from them, and it's in the middle of the night, and they don't want to get up and give you the bread, but they do anyway. There's another passage in Luke 18 where Jesus says, he told them a parable so that they would keep asking, so they would keep praying and not grow weary, so they would not give up. And it's about the lady who goes to the judge, and the judge doesn't want to give her what she wants. And she keeps going back. Finally, the judge gives her what she wants. Well, why? Not because it was his will to begin with, but because she bent his will because of her constant asking. I've always thought that was an odd thing. For me, my prayer life, I know it's a constant asking. But for Jesus to have told his disciples that, as an example, just keep going back. My Father will listen to you if you just keep going back. That may be what John is talking about, that we know that we'll have what we ask of him if we ask according to his will, means that maybe we shape his will by the things that we're asking. And then finally, we decide on something. God is not willing, but later gives us what we want. So that's what we were just talking about. So is it that according to God's will means it's already his will before we ask and he just follows through with what he was already doing? Is it that we ask according to his will meaning that it wasn't his will at the time but he immediately gives us the thing that we've asked because of who we are and how we ask? Or is it that we keep asking so long that he finally decides to give us the desire of our heart? Any one of those three may be what John is thinking of. Now, John was in the room listening when Jesus said, keep asking, keep asking, keep asking, keep asking. He was one of the ones he was teaching when he gave that model prayer and then followed it up by saying, well, it's like a friend going to ask for bread. And it's not because they really want to get up and give you the bread, but if you're going to stay on their doorstep all day, they're going to get up and give you the bread. So he pictures his Father as being one who can be influenced, whose will can be changed through prayer. And that's, I think, more in line with the way we approach prayer, but we don't usually say it that way. We think in terms of, we have a need, we keep praying for it, and then God gives it to us, so it was God's will that we have it. But was it God's will that we have it when we first started praying, or did God change things in answer to our prayers. More likely in the area of sickness. You know, so-and-so is in their, you know, fourth stage of cancer, and there's no way they're going to get better. And then they do. And we say, well, God answered our prayer. Well, was it God's will to begin with, or was it God's answer to a prayer that maybe was not originally what he was moving toward, but then moved toward it because of the prayer life? It's good questions. I don't know that I know the exact answer for all of that.
Doesn't he know what we want before we ask?
Before we ever ask, yeah. So it's a circular question, isn't it? It's all working together. One of the passages that I looked at, Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he says, you've been asking me for things. You don't have to ask me for things anymore. I'm going back to the Father, and I'm sending the Holy Spirit for you. So now if you ask the Father in my name, he'll give it to you. It wasn't a statement that he made to the multitudes. It was a statement he made to his immediate disciples. But all of us have adopted that, right? We pray in the name of Jesus. So when we go before the Father, it's not just who we are, his children. It's what we believe. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I ask for things in Jesus' name. So all of those things may be all built together in God's will being carried out in our prayer life. So anyway, put all of that stuff in your mind and melt over it for a little bit. But go to verse 16. If you see any brother or sister commit a sin that does not lead to death, you should pray, and God will give them life. So we've just gotten finished with a passage that says, if you ask God according to his will, we know that we have what we ask. The next thing is, pray for brothers and sisters that commit a sin that does not lead to death. You should pray, and God will give them life. Okay? Point of fact. Statement of truth. Not a maybe in it. Just pray, and God will. Okay? I refer to those whose sin does not lead to death. There is a sin that leads to death. I'm not saying that you should pray about that. All wrongdoing is sin, and there is a sin that does not lead to death. Now, as far as I know, all the translations translate that word, and there is a sin that does not lead to death. The word in Greek can be translated but, and I like the word but there a little bit better. There is a sin, all wrongdoing is sin, but there is a sin that does not lead to death. So, again, I went to the commentaries and tried to find out if they had a clue what this sin that does not lead to death, or the sin that does lead to death, what John might be talking about, came up with a couple of possibilities. He might be referencing back to the law of Moses. In the law of Moses, there were tons of crimes that were listed, but only a very few got the death penalty. So if you murdered someone, then you were worthy of death. Caught in the act of adultery under the old law, worthy of death. So it could be that John is saying there's certain sins that are just so strong that you wouldn't pray for somebody about that because it's just beyond any level from which they could come back. That didn't seem to ring true with the New Testament. Particularly, and I always go back to this, you get that woman at the well. The woman at the well in Samaria had been married 5 times, divorced 5 times, and was living with a man that wasn't her husband. And Jesus said, if you'll ask me, I'll give you living water. So if you take that person and she's not eligible, you know, Jesus makes her eligible by offering her living water. But note the singular, at least in the NIV, there is a sin that leads to death. I don't say you should pray about that. Okay? So it seems to be singular that there is one. Now, just so happens, Sunday, we talked a little bit about what people call the unpardonable sin, the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. Jesus says very specifically in that passage, all sins can be forgiven an individual, but the sin of blasphemy against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven in this world or in the world to come. Maybe John has that in mind, that somebody blasphemes the Spirit. Another possibility. But not everyone that John has in mind here, at least I think, not everyone that John has in mind here, would be directly guilty of the same thing of saying that Jesus was casting out demons by the power of Satan. I think John is talking about the people that he's been talking about through the whole letter. People who say Jesus is not the Christ. If they don't believe that Jesus is the Son of God, if they don't believe that Jesus came in the flesh, if they don't believe that Jesus is Messiah, what can you do for them? Okay? That sin, that opposition to God's anointed one, might be what John's talking about. But again, just like the question of prayer just before it, it's really difficult to know exactly what was on John's mind when he said, there's only one. There's a sin that is unto death, and I'm not saying that you should pray about that. Would it be okay to pray for someone who had committed a sin that was unto death? I'm sure that it's okay. I think that what John's saying is it's not going to change God's mind. If the sin is unto death, then it's not going to be forgiven. You can pray about it if you want, but it's, you know, I'm not telling you to pray about that because it's not something that's useful. However, there are sins, all wrongdoing is sin, but there are sins that don't lead to death. That one is almost as difficult as saying which one is. You know, if you could say, well, this one definitely is, well, then you've got to go to the other end of the spectrum. And what does John mean when he says all wrongdoing is sin, but there is sin that does not lead to death? So I think that's why some of the commentators thought that he was talking about the law of Moses and certain sins bringing the death penalty, because there would then be some sins that did bring death. But all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All deserve death, but through Christ, all can have life. So again, I think that John's talking about those who are openly in opposition to Jesus as the Son of God, openly in opposition to his coming in the flesh. Are there people today like that? Oh, absolutely. There's millions of them, billions of them, who openly reject the idea that Jesus is the Son of God. We could pray for them to change their mind, perhaps, but to pray for them to be saved in spite of their lack of trust or lack of faith in Jesus seems to be a futile effort. There's not something that we could do about that problem. So again, two things right in a row. The idea of what does he mean by we will receive whatever we ask in prayer, and then what does it mean if we pray for somebody for a sin that does not lead to death compared to a sin that does lead to death. Anybody have any thoughts about that? No? Okay. Well, I want us to just read down through the rest. That's the hard part. We're kind of home free now. We get back to some we knows. We know that anyone born of God does not go on sinning. The one who is born of God keeps them safe, and the evil one cannot harm them. We know that we are children of God, and that the whole world is under the control of the evil one. We know also that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding, so that we may know him who is true. We are in him who is true by being in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God. He is eternal life. And then he finishes his letter with all the things he's talked about. The most simple apostolic kind of statement he could have: dear children, keep yourself from idols. No argument, no misunderstanding, no explanation necessary. Keep yourself from idols. He was writing to people that just lived in the middle of a society that was full of them. And so after all of this deep discussion about love and obedience and prayer, he gets to the end and his last statement is, stay away from those idols. And then he's done.
So he's writing this to people who are in the middle of idols, mm-hmm. worship idols, have changed. Could it be that the ones that worship idols, they don't believe in Christ, they don't believe Christ is the Son of God, and that's why he's telling them again to stay away from the idols, because that being the sin of death, I mean, if you don't believe in God, Christ, then...
Absolutely. There were two things that idols were famous for in that era. And one of them was sexual immorality. The other one was feasting, and those two kind of went together. So all through the New Testament, you'll run into, anytime there's idols in the neighborhood, there'll be some discussion about, can we eat meat that's been offered to the idols, and can we go to parties at the temple? You know, what if somebody brings me a steak that they first offered to Zeus? Can I eat that thing or not? Can I wear my hair short if I'm a woman or long if I'm a man? All of that had to do with these idols being so prevalent in their society. So that's one of the things that the apostles kept pushing, not just to the Jews, but especially to the Gentiles, to steer clear of anything that smacked of idol worship, because it was going to suck you in and ruin, if nothing else, it would ruin your reputation. If you say, I believe in Jesus, but you're still going to Zeus parties, then, you know, it's going to ruin your reputation. And as time went by, a lot of Christians, when the persecution came, went back into idols, and instead of claiming Jesus, they claimed Zeus or Athena or whatever, because they weren't getting persecuted if they were doing that. So they could still be religious, but not be under persecution. But yeah, that's those folks. Actually, to tell you the truth, the Romans didn't care what you believed as long as you believed in the emperor. By the time emperor worship really took root, you could be a worshiper of just about anything if you would burn the incense and say that Caesar is Lord. You could think Jesus is Lord too. That was all right, but you had to say Caesar was Lord. And what got so many of us killed was we weren't willing to say Caesar is Lord, because there was only one Lord, and we weren't going to back off of that and start worshiping a human as deity. But yeah, it was a huge issue. And if he's writing to folks around Ephesus, then you know they had lots of temples in that area in Asia Minor. Bunches and several. Anybody else? Thoughts?
Is there idols today?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. World's full of them. Predominantly, when you think about idols, you think about Hinduism and Buddhism. There's a lot of very elaborate, very beautiful temples that had been built through the ages for Hindu deities. People that are living in absolute squalor. They will go to these places and beg benefits from these particular gods. But all around the world, yeah, people tend to like to make things to represent their gods. Sunday night this coming, we'll talk about don't make any graven images. We're going to get into the Ten Commandments, and that's one of those things. It's just kind of a human nature to find something to look at, to say, that's my God, to focus on that and to look for favors from this object. And so the Israelites weren't exempt. They got caught up in that all through their history, and then, you know, even after Jesus' day, they were still getting sucked in by the surroundings. Lots of idols, and it's still there. We don't have it as much in the United States. People worship physical stuff, you know, houses, cars, lands, money, whatever. But it's a little bit different. They don't pray to their money. They think in terms of I'm the God and the money serves me, rather than the money is the God and I serve the money. It may be that way, but that's not the way they look at it. In true idolatry, there's an object of affection that they believe is giving them something. And so they...
A lot of that is what I did call the cult.
Yeah. There are cults that are formed around idol worship. But, I mean, there's some... You know, usually I think of a cult as being fairly small.
Yeah.
There are some that are... Some of these idol worshiping groups are ginormous. They've got, you know, like I said, millions, even billions of adherents that follow those folks. All right. All right. Well, we'll tell you guys bye. We'll see you later.